Thank you, brethren. It is such a blessing to be here, to hear these words, to rejoice in the truth together. I want you to think about Jesus and how he was perfectly suited for us. We're going to read from Hebrews 7, verse 24 through 28. For this man, because he continueth ever, hath an unchangeable priesthood. Wherefore he is able to save them to the uttermost that come to God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. For such an high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens, who needeth not daily as the high priest to offer up sacrifice first for his own sins and then for the people's. For this he did once when he offered up himself. For the law maketh men high priests which have infirmity, but the word of the oath which was since the law maketh the Son, who is consecrated forevermore.
Yes, amen.
The high priesthood of Christ. This is critically important.
Yes, it is. Amen.
You know how important this is. Think about this particular aspect of Christ. We know a lot about Christ and his work. He was to be the Lamb. Mm-hmm. He was the Lamb of God that was slain from the foundation of the world. Mm-hmm. He was the Lamb that took away the sin of the world. Mm-hmm. He was the sacrifice. But in particular, his being priest, think about all that's said about this. Now let's look at the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. What does it say in there about the priesthood of Christ? Well, let's see, he was a high priest after the... Oh, that's Hebrews. What about in Acts? What does it say about the priesthood of Christ? He was the seed of David. He's raised up the fallen tabernacle of David. But the priesthood of Christ? What about in Romans? Do we have mention about the priesthood of Christ in Romans? And if any of you have seen something, I'd like to know. What about the epistles, the letters to the churches? Does he talk about the priesthood of Christ? The book of Revelation. What about the Old Testament? Now we have three verses in Genesis. With Melchizedek in one verse in Psalm 110, verse 4. Thou hast sworn and will not repent. Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. And then Brother Phil brought up this one in Zechariah. He said, he shall be a priest upon his throne.
Amen.
And I would love to know if you find some others. But other than the book of Hebrews, I do not see anywhere else it talks about the priesthood of Christ. As critical as this is. And so it's as if the writer of Hebrews is reading in Psalm 110. And he looks and he sees that verse 4. And there's priest forever. And he's just like a jewel. He sees it on the ground. Mm-hmm. And he goes to get it and he starts brushing away dirt. And underneath that jewel, there's a whole vast treasure, mm-hmm. a storehouse. Mm-hmm. He opened up this whole aspect of what Christ did as priest.
Amen.
We had all this detail about a priest in the Old Testament. We had all these instructions for the priest. And when we aside from Hebrews, we look at Christ when we see the Lamb, we see the offering, we see the sacrifice. And in Hebrews, he opens up this aspect that Christ is the one making the sacrifice. Christ is the one offering the offering. And let me tell you, brother, without a high priest, we don't have a chance of getting to heaven.
Right. Amen. Amen.
Not a chance of it.
Amen.
Praise God that He has opened this up to us and made us see this jewel. He's uncovered this treasure that Christ is our high priest. Now the subject is saving to the uttermost. Mm-hmm. And God is interested in saving to the uttermost. Yes. God is not one who begins to build and is not able to finish it.
That's right. Amen.
When God undertakes a work, He's going to complete it. He's not interested in those who begin and then fall away. He wants to save to the uttermost them that come to God by Him. And so we have this high priest. You know, Jude told us that there were some who, after the Lord had saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed them that believed not.
Amen.
This is not God's purpose to bring them out of Egypt to destroy them. Now, of course, God is not... One who begins to build is not able to finish. He counted the cost. God counted the cost. And a high price it was. When He thought about saving us, it wasn't a small thing. He counted the cost and said it's worth it. Moses, remember, he interceded for the people with God, and he said, "Now if thou shalt kill all this people as one man, then the nations which have heard the fame of thee will speak, saying, because the Lord was not able to bring this people into the land which He sware unto them, therefore He has slain them in the wilderness." So God wanted a way to save to the uttermost.
Amen.
Them that come to God by Him. Now bringing the people into the land, of course the limitation was not with God's ability to deliver, but with the people's weakness. The law was weak through the flesh. They couldn't save to the uttermost by the law. And so God is going to deal with the true problem in man, the heart of the problem. In 1 Samuel 13, Samuel says to Saul, Saul was appointed king, but Samuel said to Saul, "Thou hast done foolishly, thou hast not kept the commandment of the Lord thy God, which He commanded thee, for now would the Lord have established thy kingdom upon Israel forever. But now thy kingdom shall not continue. The Lord has sought him a man after his own heart, and the Lord hath commanded him to be captain over his people, because thou hast not kept that which the Lord commanded thee." So in a sense, under the law, we didn't keep that which was commanded us. And so God said, "I'm going another way." So we're not going with Saul anymore. We're going to go for a man after God's own heart. And so God is going to deal with the heart of the matter, which is our hearts. Saving to the uttermost required God to deal with the root problem in man. They do always err in their heart. Isn't that what it said? And so God deals with the heart in the new covenant. He promises He would put a new heart within us, a new spirit. And I will cause you to walk in my ways.
Amen.
So God is working a work that's saving to the uttermost
them
that come to God by Him. And God is able to do this to His own master. He stands or falls, another man's servant. And it says, Romans 4:14, "Yea, he shall be holden up, for God is able to make him stand."
Amen.
Sometimes I just sense this, that God is underneath, holding me up, making me stand. "He shall be holden up, for God is able to make him stand." He's
Amen.
Able to save to the uttermost.
Amen.
1 Corinthians 1, verse 7. They're waiting for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. who shall also confirm you unto the end.
Amen.
That you may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. And God is faithful, it says the next words. God is faithful. So you think about this salvation and the coming of Christ. I want to be ready on that day.
Amen.
There are many people, when that day dawns, when Jesus Christ comes and the sky splits open, and every man stands before the holy God, they will give an account. I want to have boldness in the day of judgment.
Amen. Amen.
I want to stand. I want to look up and say, this is our God. We have waited for him.
Amen.
This is our God. We have waited for him and he will save us.
Amen.
We don't have to have fear because God saves to the uttermost.
Amen.
Them that come unto God by him. And he will confirm unto the end, to the end, that we may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. When the blazing glory of Christ's holiness shines on this world, he's not going to see anything in us.
Amen.
We are clean through the word which he's spoken to us. He cleansed us from all unrighteousness. The righteousness of the law is fulfilled in us. We have the righteousness of God in him. Jude said that he is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the throne presence of his glory with exceeding joy. So this, he's able to save to the uttermost.
Amen.
Peter said that we're kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed. Boy, it just makes you realize underneath are the everlasting arms.
Amen.
Sometime you think you had a good day. God is the one keeping us.
Amen.
God is the one holding us up. He's making us stand. And one day he will change our vile body that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body.
Amen.
According to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself.
Amen.
So God, I want you to see God's work in this. He is subduing us to himself.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Paul said to Timothy that he suffered. He said, nevertheless, I'm not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Isn't that good to know that we've got a high priest who not just begins the work, but he'll bring us all the way till Jesus Christ is able.
Amen.
And so, brethren, we're confident of this very thing, which he that hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He is able to save to the uttermost.
Amen.
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 And so, how is he able to save to the uttermost? Continual intercession.
Uh-huh. Amen.
Now, you are precious brethren. I love you dearly. But it's not easy to save you.
Amen.
Not at all. It's not easy to save me. Think of what it required. Ever liveth to make intercession for us.
Amen.
He's ever at the right hand of the Father, interceding for us.
Amen.
What if he took a day off? Ever liveth. See, this is what our salvation required. It required a continual intercession on our behalf. What shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? Romans 8:31.
Amen.
He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It is God that justifieth. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather, that is risen again. Now it says, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us.
Amen.
This is part of the whole salvation package. You don't want to miss this.
That's right.
Yes, he died for our sins. But part of bringing us saving to the uttermost meant that he's at the right hand interceding for us.
Amen.
I guess there you get a little picture of the priesthood of Christ there.
Yes.
Also, a hint in Ephesians 5, 2. Mm-hmm. He shall see the travail of his soul, Isaiah 53. Right? 11. And shall be satisfied by his knowledge, shall my righteous servant justify many. I'm glad I'm in that many, aren't
Amen.
You?
Amen.
For he shall bear their iniquities, therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death.
Amen.
He was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors.
Amen.
He bore the sin, and he made intercession. I just come to appreciate more fully this work that's going on for us now of intercession. Mm-hmm. Where would we be without it?
Amen.
God saw the condition of man and wondered that there was no intercessor. It displeased him, displeased God that there was no one to stand in the gap between him and man. Therefore, his own arm brought salvation unto him, and his righteousness it sustained him. He made an intercessor for us.
Amen.
There's one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus.
Amen.
And continual mediation between the Father and the Son. And as we come to Jesus and we see him, we've seen the Father. So this is a great work that God is doing. He's saving to the uttermost. He ever lives to make intercession. Christ hasn't entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself now to appear in the presence of God for us.
Amen.
That's what he's doing now. Mm-hmm. I hope you can appreciate how much the Scripture talks about what he's doing now in
Amen.
Our behalf. He said it is finished on the cross, and all the price was paid for our salvation. But his work wasn't finished.
That's right. Amen.
He's interceding for us.
Amen.
In fact, if any man sin, we have what?
An
advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is a propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sin of the whole world.
Amen.
He ever lives to make intercession for us. He's able to bring us. And so this kind of priest became us. Became us. It's what we needed.
Yep.
Amen.
Yeah.
We needed this priest.
Amen.
He's what we needed. Perfect to meet our need.
Amen.
So Jesus, as priest, is exactly what we needed.
Mm-hmm.
But on a higher level, Jesus is exactly what the Father needed also.
Amen.
Amen.
So it wasn't God's eternal purpose. We've talked about that. God's desire was to save man. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And so God needed a way to save man. It became the Father that he have a high priest like this.
Amen.
And Jesus was perfect for accomplishing our redemption. Now Jesus was made like us, but not altogether like us. We've read in Hebrews 2 that he took upon himself flesh and blood, that he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them from fear of death who all their lifetime were subject to bondage. For verily he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Wherefore in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to succor them that are tempted. in this sense, Christ had to come and be like us and live our life and suffer and be able to relate to us in that way. But as high priest, it is different. For it became him. For such an high priest became us who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, made higher than the heaven. That's not like us. Praise God. He came to be like us so that he might be a merciful high priest, that he might be a faithful high priest. But he wasn't like us so that he could offer a perfect offering.
Amen.
So that he could minister in the true tabernacle.
Amen.
A servant of the tabernacle.
Amen.
He was like us so he could be touched with the feeling of our infirmities. But he was not like us so he could take away our infirmities.
Amen.
He became like us in that he was sent in the likeness of sinful flesh, not like us in that he was not sinful flesh.
Mm-hmm.
He became like us so that he could be tempted, but not like us in that he was yet without sin.
Amen.
He became like us so that he could die. He wouldn't have been able to die if he wasn't made flesh. But not like us in that he could not see corruption. It was not possible for death to hold him. The wages of sin is death, and here's a spotless lamb dead. It doesn't add up. He's got to come out. He was raised up. Well, what characteristics did we specifically need in a high priest? What specifically about a high priest did we need? For such a high priest became us? Well, he had to be holy.
Yes.
Amen. He had to be holy.
Amen.
In order for intercession to be effective, he had to be clean. Acts 2:27. Because thou wilt not leave my soul in hell, neither wilt thou suffer thine holy one to see corruption.
Amen.
There's a body in the tomb, and it's the holy one.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. We have a holy high priest.
Amen.
Jesus did no sin.
Amen.
God made him to be sin for us who knew no sin.
Amen.
I write this to you that ye sin not, 1 John. But if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous.
Amen.
He did no sin. He was the spotless Lamb of God.
Amen.
We know that he was manifested to take away our sin, and in him is no sin.
Amen.
He is holy. He did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. And when he looked at his enemies, his accusers, he said, "Which of you convicteth me of sin?"
Amen.
No one had a thing they could say, not a word, not even a hint of sin in the holy, separate from sinners, high priest for us. And like Pilate said, we say the same thing. I find no fault in him.
Yeah.
He is holy. What? I'm reading through Leviticus again and thinking about all these details for the priests. Man, if you were born in Aaron's house, and you start looking at all these things you had to do, I'd be afraid to even move. Hey, if this happens, you have to do this kind of sacrifice. If this, you do this and then. It's just page after page after page of details. And see, this, the high priest was going to be a representative representative of Christ, our high priest, and he had to be perfect. He had to be holy. And so all these details show that it's not a small thing.
Right.
To be high priest.
Amen.
It's
Amen.
Not a casual thing. You don't just
right.
imagine if you brought your sacrifice for sin. Oh, I'm guilty before God. I need forgiveness. And you bring your sacrifice. And there's a high priest standing there in jeans and a t-shirt. Casual. Oh, yeah, I'll take care of this later. He had to be holy.
Amen.
He had to be accepted by God.
Amen.
And he was, brethren. Think of the confidence we have in coming to him.
Amen.
That when we come, we know that his sacrifice is accepted of the Father.
Amen.
He is holy. He's also harmless.
Mm-hmm.
David was going to build the temple of the Lord. He wanted to. Because he had shed blood, he was unfit to build the house of God. So God said, your son will build it. Now, his son is harmless, the son of David, Jesus Christ, thou son of David. He was harmless. He can build the temple. When he was reviled, he reviled not again. He was as a sheep before her shearers, as dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was harmless. Imagine the uproar against him and the hatred against him. He was harmless. Put up your sword, he said. He yielded himself to those men. Who are you seeking? Jesus of Nazareth. I am he. They all fell on the ground.
Amen.
He wasn't captured. He gave himself to them. He said, here, follow me. It was almost as if he was leading the way. He was harmless. And so the picture of the lamb comes in, brings out this aspect of Christ. He was harmless. He had to be holy. He had to be harmless. He was undefiled.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus Christ was undefiled. Mm-hmm. The lamb was to be without blemish and without spot.
Mm-hmm.
Now, a blemish is something that happens to you as a matter of experience. See, a scrape on the fence, or you break a leg or something. This is a blemish. But it's also Jesus was without spot.
Amen.
That's something you're born with.
Mm-hmm.
We were born with a spot.
Mm-hmm.
Because of Adam's sin, death passed upon all men.
Amen.
We had the spot. We also had the blemishes.
Amen.
We had fallen experientially into sin, but Jesus Christ never was blemished.
Amen.
And
Amen.
Never, because of the virgin birth, he was without spot also. Your lamb shall be without blemish. A male of the first year. Ye shall offer at your own will a male without blemish of the beeves of the sheep or of the goats, but whatsoever hath a blemish, that shall ye not offer. For it shall not be acceptable for you. And whosoever offereth the sacrifice of peace offering unto the Lord to accomplish his vow, or a freewill offering of the beeves or sheep, it shall be perfect to be accepted. There shall be no blemish therein. In fact, 46 times they use that phrase, without blemish. He was also without spot. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works. So he was undefiled. We were redeemed with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. And it says also that he was separate from sinners.
Mm-hmm.
I'm getting close to the end here. Bear with me. But Jesus was separate from sinners. I know we have a hymn we sing, Friend of Sinners, and I think we need to be careful about this. Sometimes I think when people talk about Jesus being a friend of sinners, they get this idea that he's cavorting with them in the bars and just hanging around with them. Well, the scripture says he was separate from sinners.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh, to be true, he was a friend of this sinner. When I saw Jesus, I realized I was undone.
Amen.
I said,
Amen.
This sin is dragging me to hell. I've got to get rid of it.
Amen. Amen.
I repented. I cried out to him for mercy.
Amen.
In that sense, he was a friend of
mm-hmm.
the sinner.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
But he is separate from sinners in that he has no association with sinners. He's separate from sinners. In fact, the work of salvation was done by God himself. It was not done by man. Jesus didn't come to help us with the atonement. Jesus came to do the atonement.
Amen.
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 It was done without hands. Jesus was the brightness of God's glory. And the express image of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power. This is Hebrews 1:3. When he had by himself purged our sins.
Amen.
He was separate from sinners in this work of atonement.
Amen.
He did it by himself.
Amen.
In fact, you know, on the day of atonement, God said you're going to have a day each year, this day of atonement, the sacrifice is going to be made. But he said, whatsoever soul it be that doeth any work in that same day, the same soul will I destroy. How about that? The same soul will I destroy from among his people. When the atonement's being made, no one's working but the priest.
Amen.
No one else is going to be involved in this work. Everyone else sit down, separate from sinners. The high priest alone is going to make this sacrifice. No one else is working.
Amen.
This is God's work, and Jesus did it by himself.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone forsook him. His disciples all forsook him.
Mm-hmm.
He tread the winepress alone.
Amen.
He was separate from sinners. And praise God he was, because it would have tainted the sacrifice.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Anything you try and do and add to what Christ has done is going to taint the sacrifice.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to corrupt it and pollute it. But praise God, our high priest is separate from sinners.
Mm-hmm.
And he's exalted. He's higher than the heavens.
Amen.
So this is how he is able to be at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for us.
Amen.
Holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners,
mm-hmm.
made higher than the heavens. Such an high priest became
Amen.
Us.
Amen.
What does this mean for us? Jesus was made like us, but not like us,
mm-hmm.
so that he could make us like him.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
See, he's making us so that we are holy, harmless. If someone strikes you on the right cheek, turn to them the left. You're harmless, undefiled. We're made clean, separate from sinners. No fellowship between light and darkness.
Mm-hmm.
Made higher than the heavens. He's going to exalt us too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in the priest's house, the priest was given to eat of the sacrifices. Some of them. His food came from the sacrifices they offered. But it said of the priest, there shall no stranger eat of the holy things. A sojourner of the priest or an hired servant shall not eat of the holy things. But it says, but if a priest buy any soul with his money, he shall eat of it. And he that is born in his house, they shall eat of his meat. Here we have the priest. If you've got a hired servant, he can't eat of it. A stranger, Gentile, he can't eat of it. But if this priest buys with his own money a servant. Brethren, we were bought at a price.
Amen.
Jesus bought us.
Yes,
we get to eat of the holy things.
Amen.
Or also, if someone's born in his house, we were born again. We were born in his house. We get the priest's food. Amen. So Jesus welcomes us, take and eat.
Amen. They're
the holy things, take and eat. We get to be made like him. Well, praise God that this high priest became us. There's so much more to say, but I offer these things to you and to the Lord.
Amen.
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 I really appreciated you really emphasizing the point that he's able to save to the uttermost. That's really
Amen.
When we're talking about a high priest.
Amen.
Not just the lamb, I think you pointed out. Not just the lamb that was slain, but a high priest that ever liveth.
Amen.
We certainly need him.
He's talking about such a high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, made higher than the heavens. Malachi 1:8 says, "And if you offer the blind for sacrifice, is it not evil? And if you offer the lame and sick, is it not evil? Offer it now unto thy governor. Will he be pleased with thee, or accept thy person, saith the Lord of hosts? And now I pray you, beseech God that he will be gracious unto us. This hath been by your means. Will he regard your person, saith the Lord of hosts?" And we needed a holy sacrifice.
Amen.
For God.
Amen.
Will the Lord accept our persons? If we had just kept offering our own unholy offerings, this was not enough for God. Is it not evil, he said.
Mm-hmm.
We needed someone who was holy.
Amen.
And
Amen.
Unpolluted. And
Amen.
He's not a blind or a lame sacrifice. He is
Amen.
Perfectly what we needed. And he perfectly satisfies the Father.
Amen.
Amen.
I liked what he said about he will see nothing in us when he comes. Because that'll bring forth that what he will see is a true reflection of his Son, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And that's just such a comforting.
I like that too.
Comforting.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
I appreciated the
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That was very, very
Amen.
Yeah, I was thinking about that.
Yeah.
Remember, pure and undefiled religion in the sight of our God and Father is to visit the widows and the orphans in their distress and to keep oneself unspotted, unstained, unblemished
mm-hmm.
by
Amen.
The world. Christ did pure and undefiled religion. You know, he really he did all those things.
You know, for those people who say that we just go to the Old Testament and talk about all history and things like that, we talk about everlasting and continual.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's right.
That brought it up today. It's continual. It's right now. Mm-hmm. It's today.
Amen.
Amen. That high priest is interceding on our behalf continually.
Yeah.
Amen.
Jesus, yesterday, today, forever, is the same.
Mm-hmm.
It's the same.
This distinction that Brother Tim made, that he's like us, but he's not like us, is very critical for us to see.
Mm-hmm.
And we've got to, your faith has to sort that out, not just your mental capacities, although that's certainly involved, but this has to be comprehended by your faith, you know, to see the sense in which he was like us, he identified with us, and then there's another sense in which he was not like us, you know.
Mm-hmm.
He did no sin, and he knew no sin. And,
mm-hmm.
and that's important for us to see, that there was one of our number that did no sin.
Amen.
One of us did no sin, and we're in him.
Mm-hmm.
And we're in him, and he's our representative, and he's the one who laid down his life for us. But this, it's a critical distinction, matter for us to see.
Mm-hmm.
actually begins by a revelation of himself. And I want to make this point about this, as the high priest has brought into the picture here. The scripture says that of God, that thou art of pure eyes and to behold evil, and he cannot look upon iniquity. That's the truth. Mm-hmm. He's the same. He changeth not.
Right.
So who then is able to come before this holy
mm-hmm.
God?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Someone that has a blemish, a spot. See, so this, as the announcement is made of the necessity of one being here in the presence of God, he cannot have a spot or a blemish.
Mm-hmm.
God will not receive or accept such a one. I mean, that's, I am the Lord, I changeth not. This, he announced this from the beginning, and he continues to announce it now.
Mm-hmm.
If men are going to have anything to do with God, that high priest had better be there. That's
mm-hmm.
the point
yeah,
statement
yeah.
there. Because he cannot look upon iniquity. Who among men is going to be able to come before this God?
Mm-hmm.
Now, see, he's made the. He found one. See, it was God who found one.
Mm-hmm.
He found
yeah.
one that was holy and harmless and separate from sinners and undefiled. And see, God found this one,
mm-hmm.
and he is the one that he set at his right hand.
Yeah.
He's the one that's ever living to make intercession for us.
Amen.
That's what ministers to faith. See, that's what gives us boldness to come before the throne of God.
Yeah.
Amen.
Because Jesus, the high priest, is there.
Yeah.
Amen.
We see that a sacrifice had to be holy, had to be pure, unblemished.
Mm-hmm.
But also, Christ, as the high priest, has mm-hmm. to be holy, unblemished.
Right. Amen.
Because as you're saying, God will not accept someone in his presence who is
right.
sinful.
Mm-hmm.
And talking, it made me think of what God said to Job's friends. And it was so that after the Lord had spoken these words unto the Job, the Lord said to Eliphaz the Temanite, my wrath is kindled against thee and against thy two friends, for ye have not spoken of me the thing that is right, as my servant Job hath. And so this is us, that we were not accepted before God. Says, therefore take unto you now 7 bullocks and 7 rams, and go to my servant Job, and offer up for yourselves a burnt offering, and my servant Job shall pray for you. For him will I accept,
mm-hmm.
lest I deal with you after your folly.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
So, there, the one making intercession had to be somebody who God accepts.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And that's why Jesus had to be holy, harmless, undefiled.
That's right.
Him will God accept.
Yep.
Amen.
Amen.
We are accepted
in the blood.
By the shedding of that pure, blameless, blemish-free blood, we can approach God boldly
yeah.
into the throne of grace, and he can look upon us because he doesn't see our infirmities, but he sees the perfection of his Son.
That's right.
And that's why we can come before him.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just to say what Brother Richard mentioned about the things that are revealed in Moses and the prophets and the Psalms, God is beginning to lay this foundation of his ways and his work.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
He's announcing here to Abraham. There were those who were saved because of someone else.
Yep. Uh-huh.
How about Noah?
Yeah.
How about Noah?
Yep.
I mean, what was it about? What was it about those ones that
mm-hmm.
his family?
Mm-hmm.
What was it said about his family that they were with him?
Yeah.
Okay. How about with Lot? How about Lot? When Lot was there? I mean, what was it said about his family? It was because of Lot.
Mm-hmm.
And God even further on after Abraham had died from this from this world. There were things God was doing because of Abraham's sake.
Yeah.
He made promises to Abraham, and that's why God was doing these works, because it was for Abraham's sake.
Mm-hmm.
And you take that into the New Covenant, he talks about for Christ's sake.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That God is doing these works. Again, these things were all being laid out. He didn't change. He didn't change his manner in doing things. He began to reveal from the beginning about his very nature and character and his ways. This is how God works.
Mm-hmm.
But see, it's glorious in our sight
mm-hmm.
because of Jesus. See,
mm-hmm.
that's why we're being saved. It's for his sake.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But see, and he began to show us this from the very beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about the high high priest that became us. And there were certain things that had to be, that this high priest had to be fitting for us. And there are lots of requirements for this high priest. And there was only one high priest. There was only one to fit this category. And so as the psalmist said, whom have I in heaven but thee?
Yeah.
There is none upon the earth that I desire beside thee. So because of all our needs, because we needed this one high priest, there was only one who met our needs. This causes us to love him. And this causes us to seek only him because he is the fulfillment of what we need.
Amen.
Yes.
And there is none other, and we want to go to him.
Mm-hmm.
Because he is the high priest that became us.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Amen.
I appreciated you laboring on that word uttermost, and the fact that he's able to save to the uttermost. Because it's someone who is not yet attained, that's good news.
Mm-hmm.
That sounds like I can use some saving still, so it's good news.
Yeah.
That he's able to perform that,
yeah,
and complete it.
Yeah.
And that God he doesn't start things that he's not going to finish. He mentioned that he had counted the cost.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
And just that, you briefly mentioned that you said that he counted the cost and found us worthy of the payment. That's quite the consideration.
Job, remember, and this has already been alluded to, I forget who mentioned, remember, I think it was Brother Durante, he desired someone that would be able to put their hand on him and upon God and bring him together, like this, King James is the word
a daysman,
right? This is like an umpire or or an arbitrator. Now Job wished for something like that, but that really wouldn't have been adequate because we really needed an arbitrator that could deal with sin.
Mm-hmm.
See, but now God has provided, he's actually provided from his own from his own person, from the foundation of the world, actually, this high priest, this originated with God. It wasn't man's idea. It was God's. It originated from God's mind, and he's called a mediator and intercessor as well, which.
Mm-hmm. I was thinking how, remember, I think it's in Isaiah where God speaking says that I looked upon the face of the earth and I saw that there was no man.
Yeah.
So my own arm brought salvation.
Amen. Amen.
You know, and this is still how it is. That wasn't like a time in history when he decided to do this. Okay,
yeah.
Now I brought salvation. Now go ahead and finish it off. We still need a man. We still need salvation brought to us. You know, salvation is by grace through faith. And it's not just trusting in what Christ has done, but what he's currently doing. You know, we're still dependent on him. We didn't start by the Spirit, now perfected by the flesh. That's not how it is. You know, we're still in constant dependence. And this is why the exhortation is appropriate to draw near.
Uh-huh.
You know, and he's able to provide. You know, about for Brother Mike, you were talking about for the sake of another. You made me think about Mephibosheth. Remember, he's kind of like how we were. You know, he's kind of infirmed and crippled and can't really do a whole lot. But because of his father, because the king was friends with Jonathan, he was able to sit at the king's table. It's just kind of.
Amen.
You look at these things. Why is that account in here?
Yes,
well, this
right.
is why. So because we can associate with these things. We see, wow, this is I'm feeling like Mephibosheth right now. That there's one who's accepted, and I'm able to sit at the king's table. So what else do we do than just praise?
Yeah.
You know, just praise God and thank Him for His grace and mercy.
Well, let's say it in the words of the heavenly angel: the testimony of Jesus is the Spirit of God.
That's right. Yeah.
As God gives us grace to see this, He's testifying
mm-hmm.
testifying. He's testifying of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
From the beginning of the scripture, he's testifying to Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Just ask for grace to see it.
In the priesthood of Christ, as I misspoke about a hint in Ephesians 5. It's Ephesians 5:25, husbands love your wives even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. That he might sanctify it and cleanse it with the washing of water of word. There's a little hint of the priestly work there.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But there's not really much outside of the book of Hebrews,
right?
And how gloriously it's expanded and opened up. And we see it's a vital part of the salvation. In the book of Hebrews, I appreciate that.
Speaking, given the audience.
In Romans 5, there's an allusion to the high priesthood of Christ, that we might be saved by his life. And then in
mm-hmm.
chapter 8, Brother Tim already mentioned that one about making
intercession
for us.
Yeah.
So, but those are passing allusions. I don't mention it. It's not mentioned
specifically, but they're there.
Any other thoughts you want to share? I know there's lots of other thoughts.
The verse in Romans where it says God is able to make him see. That's really affirming. We always should, but when things can be pointed back to God.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think verses like that is really stripping your faith.
Mm-hmm.
I can't stand, he's able.
Yes, right.
He's able to make.
Amen.
Yeah, we're just like Abraham in that sense. Consider not your own. Don't consider your own body, your own strength, but the promise of God. That's when we grow strong in faith, giving glory to God.